Hello Internet, this is Oscar Lise again. In this video, I'll be going over Broyden's method for solving systems of nonlinear equations. We'll go over the motivation and history, then some examples, and finally some discussion. For this video, you should already be aware of generalized units method and have some familiarity with generalized finite difference method. In 1965, Broyden published a class of methods for solving nonlinear simultaneous equations, in which he tries to improve Newton's method. He notes some drawbacks of the method, mainly that the Jacobian is expensive to compute even if you try to use approximation and that it can diverge. But on the plus side, the algorithm is simple and its convergence is rapid. Furthermore, it has few competitors. What if there were less evaluations of the Jacobian, a way to update the Jacobian, and a way to avoid divergence? Broyden cites Newton's method and then creates a variable he calls B, which is an approximation to the Jacobian. He also uses a variable t meant to avoid divergence, which is a topic I'm not going to cover in this video. Let's take a step back and look at nonlinear systems, like this one, which has these four solutions. This slide shows Newton's method solving that nonlinear system. It's from my earlier lesson on Newton's method. Let's pay attention just to two columns. Here we have our sequence of steps, x, as well as the Jacobian at those points. Let's fill in that last one. One interesting behavior is that the Jacobian doesn't change a whole lot after the first few steps. Let's add back in the column for f, then take the differences between each x and each f. If you multiply the Jacobian against that change in x, we get this result, which matches very closely with our change in f. This is what Broyden noticed. Here's our approximation as we would normally write it today. This is how Broyden wrote it. Again, that t value is meant to avoid divergence, so we'll just let that be equal to 1. P is actually our change in x. Let's try to use this approximation to solve for j, which is an n-to-n matrix. The trouble is, our right side is an n-element vector, which means this is an underdetermined system. Broyden adds some conditions, essentially letting the change in the perpendicular direction be orthogonal to the current one, essentially adding these two constraints. This lets him then solve for j. Broyden gives this notation, but we can kind of simplify it using some of his earlier notation. If we let s be equal to t, which becomes 1. Therefore, we get something that looks like this. Broyden also replaces that change in f with a y variable. Then from this equation, we can normally represent it in modern terms like this, but it's still kind of long. We can simplify it just to eliminate some of those of x's. Then if we use Newton's method and take the inverse of j, we get Broyden's method. Well, almost. Even though it's not exactly Broyden's method, it's still useful. Let's try it on our earlier system, starting from the point 1, 2, evaluating the function at that point, as well as the Jacobian. You could also use differencing to find this. Then use Newton's method to find our next value for x and evaluate the function at that point. Afterwards, find our differences in our x and our differences in f and use those to compute our next Jacobian. Then use Newton's method again. Here's what that full iteration would look like. And for the first iteration, I actually used differencing to approximate the Jacobian and compared it to the actual Jacobian. It's very close. Broyden actually takes things one step further from his almost Broyden method by noticing this J inverse. What if we could solve for the inverse of J rather than J? And he does that, letting H, his approximation to the inverse, this equation. In reality, you could use what's known as the Sherman-Morrison formula, cited from this paper, that looks like this to solve for the updating inverse, but Broyden actually didn't know this formula. In modern terms, our approximation for J inverse would look like this, and then you apply Newton's method and you get Broyden's method. Well, one version of Broyden's method. Here's our same problem from earlier, only this time we're using the inverse of the Jacobian. Our first step was still from the finite difference, though. Notice how close our approximations still are. That version of Broyden's method is known as the good Broyden method. There's another way that Broyden actually solved it, which is colloquially known as the bad method. And there's another method that's been sort of forgotten by history, which looks like this. In modern terms, our methods would look like this. Let's talk about where the bad method gets its reputation from. In Broyden's paper, he notes that the second method appeared unsatisfactory in practice, swiftly deciding that in every case tried, it rapidly reached a state where successive step vectors p sub I and p sub I plus 1 were identical, and further progress thus became impossible. But is his reputation deserved? In a faster Broyden method, Kavalin writes that the second method doesn't perform badly when you make some improvements, and he also thanks Broyden for their correspondence regarding the paper. Fans of this channel will know that I've made many videos solving for roots, which I then generalize for solving systems. For example, generalized Newton's method, generalized Secant method, fixed point iteration, two versions of Stephenson's method, and finite difference. This video was all about Broyden's method, which comes from generalized Newton's method, but some folks would argue that it comes actually from Secant method. It could be argued that because we're reusing our last point and our notation looks so similar, that this has to be a generalization of Secant method. And you'll note in the literature, even in this just example paper, folks will say that Broyden describes a class of Secant methods based on the Secant equation. There are those who argue, though, like Broyden, who never used the word secant in his paper trying to improve on Newton's method, as well as the initial conditions requiring a single starting point and Jacobian, which Secant method doesn't require. And there's also the Wolf-Bittner method, which reuses everything but the last point and is exactly equivalent to Secant method for a single function. In 2000, Broyden wrote on the discovery of the good Broyden method, which he gives his take. Fun fact, he also dedicates the paper to Bill Davidson. Broyden was of the mind that he was trying to improve Newton's method. He was also aware of Davidson Fletcher Powell, which probably deserves its own video, but went with the mindset that this was of conjugate and gradient method. And he was also aware of Davidson's paper, but hadn't read it. If he had tried to generalize Secant method, that would have resulted in collinear steps instead of the orthogonal approach that he went with. And as a fun tidbit, the fact that Broyden's method uses a rank 1 update was a complete coincidence. For more about rank 1 updates, check out the Sherman-Morrison formula. Now we come to the topic of order, and it's complicated. In 71, Broyden was able to prove that it was at least linear. And then he and several others were able to prove that it was at least superlinear 2 years later. And it wasn't until 1979 that Gay was able to prove that the order was quadratic. In summary, Broyden's method can be used to solve systems of nonlinear equations with a quadratic order of convergence, and you only need to evaluate Jacobian once, or approximate it using finite differences. You also reuse the last x and last f of x in order to update your Jacobian inverse. There's also no need to invert a matrix after the first time, and that there are multiple versions of Broyden's method. His approach to avoid divergence I am not discussing in this lesson. The code that I wrote for this video will be hosted on GitHub. As always, thank you for watching and for your support on these videos. If you want to support the channel, you can do so by liking and commenting, as well as supporting me through GitHub sponsors. This video covered some of the most complex math on this channel so far, and I really hope things made sense. Again, thank you for watching.